pray that the words that come out of my mouth will be your words, Father. And I pray that we will open our minds and our hearts this evening, Father, and understand more about the parable of the soil. I thank you, Lord, for giving me the opportunity again to serve this evening, Father. And this we ask you, let us all say amen. Well, thank God for the praise team, right? They're awesome. You sit there and you just get all worked up and you just gotta wait. You gotta tell the Holy Spirit to help me out here. But you know, the Lord, the praise team is awesome because we can praise the Lord with the word and we can praise the Lord with prayer. And we've been doing that tonight. But you know, praising the Lord with music is awesome. That just gets you all motivated and pumped up to do what you need to do. And what we need to do tonight is praise the Lord. Amen. Third night, and this is a marathon. We have to be prepared. I actually have been working out for this since 1969, so I've been working out a lot just to do this crusade. Amen. Life-changing, divine messages. And you know, the Lord spoke to us in common language so we could understand, just as that. And for you that are here, visitors that have been here for most of the nights, and those that are here tonight, man, you guys are in for it. So you need to buckle up, because the Lord's gonna work us, give us a good workout tonight. Let me see if I can get my thing going. See, yeah, I've been doing this a couple of nights already. I'm still trying to figure out my switches. The parable of the soil, divine messages. But before I get into that, my wife is in Abilene still. We have a new grandbaby. It's a cute little thing. But guess what? Last night it kept them awake all night. So they're tired today. So we told our daughter, you know, this is one of many, many. But today the baby's doing well. And they also said, oh, we're going to be missing it. And I said, no, you're not, because we got Nick in the house. Nick is recording this. He's going to record it. The audio room is doing an awesome job. And the recording is, they're going to put it online, too. And there's going to probably be CDs, I believe. Is there going to be CDs? Oh, yeah, thumbs up. Two thumbs up. We have tons of people in that audio room tonight, so there's a lot of help out in there. But I told my wife, don't worry about it. Just get online and you'll be able to check it out. So, because that's how we roll here at Three Angels and stuff. And just like I've been telling everybody, we don't water nothing down here. It's straight the word of Christ. Amen? So, wow. It was a busy week. It has been a week already for me. It's just been going and going. The first night, we talked about leaven. Transforming your heart and allowing the right seed or the word of the Lord to enter your heart, right? So we established that first night. Last night, once you have that relationship and that connection with the Lord, last night we talked about the vine and the branch, making that power connection. You gotta make that connection with Christ. Once you have that connection with Christ, now we're gonna see, because now that you know some of the parables of what Jesus was talking about, now it's your turn to go out and tell others. Because if you remember what we're talking about, Christ is what? He's the light, he's the life, he's the truth, right? And the word is in you now, and now it's your job to go out and spread those seeds. And that's what we're going to talk about tonight, the soil. What kind of soil do you have? And we're going to talk two different types of soils, but tonight we're going to talk about the parable of the soil. It's an awesome, and you all should have Bibles. Do me a favor if you can. And if you're new here and you're having a hard time finding the scriptures, there's people out there that can help you out. So just raise your hand or just sit next to somebody that's experienced and seasoned and knows how to open up the Bible. How's everybody doing this evening? Good to have you guys here this evening. The parable of the soil. We'll turn your Bibles to the book of Matthew. We're going to the book, the 13th chapter, and we're going to verses 3 to 6. Matthew chapter 13, verses 3 to 6. We gotta get excited tonight. It's all about the Lord this evening, and it's awesome that you're here. There's a reason why you're here. God has you here for a reason tonight. The parable of the soil, Matthew chapter 13, verse 3 and 6. And the Bible tells us, and he spake, as we start in verse 3, And he spake many things unto them in parables, saying, Behold, a sower went forth to sow. And verse 4 says, And when he sowed, some seeds fell by the wayside, and the fowls came and devoured them up. 5 tells us that some fell upon stony places where they had not much earth. And forthwith they sprung up, and because they had no deepness of earth. Verse 6, And when the sun was up, they were scorched, and because they had no root, they withered away. As all parables that Christ talked about to his disciples, and this particular parable, Christ is talking to his disciples. He's training them, just like he's training us tonight. Amen? Behold, the sower went forth to sow. Turn your Bibles to John. We're in the New Testament, so it's Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And we're going to John 13. Isn't that awesome? The turning of pages. Some of you may have those iPads and those high-speed phones, and you have John chapter 13 already, and we're going to go to verse 1. And let's see what our Lord's talking about here. What? I apologize. We're not there yet, but give me a few seconds. It says, Behold, a sower went forth to sow. Our Lord, the master preacher. Here we go. We're on track now. Our Lord, the master preacher. He uses illustrations taken from that which was common knowledge to his hearers to illuminate their minds with the truth he taught. So Christ used basic common things for people to understand. He was not trying to make it all confusing. As you know, Jesus was, during this time, the Pharisees and the government were trying to catch him in a situation where they could take his life or take him and imprison him. So Christ right here says, our Lord, the master preacher, he's illustrating this with this parable. And in 2 it says, the timing and purpose of this parable. In Matthew and Mark, this parable appears as the first of a great collection of messages spoken on his early Galilean mission. So we're talking, this parable was taking place in Christ while Jesus was preaching in the earlier parts of his preaching. And it tells us here that a special application was taking place here. Let me back up. Yeah, no, we're right. We're good. So it teaches us that our Lord was under no illusion about the result of the work. Three-fourths of it, and we're talking about the parable of the soil, and there's four types of people we're talking about. But here, it's telling us that three-fourths of it, we might say, seems to have been a disappointment. Whatever Christ had experienced in his life as he was preaching to people, he had experienced four different classes of people. And three of those four disappointed him. Now, let's look. I think I'm just going a little too fast. So let's back up just a little. Here we are, we're right here. Now, out of the four classes of hearers, people that were listening, people that were knowing about the word, three produced extremely unsatisfactory results. He tells them that, what does he tell them? He tells them that they must expect to meet the same kinds of conditions and in fact the same results as they had seen him meet. You see, Christ, as you go out to the field, and the field I'm talking about to the world, and as you start talking to people, you start talking to people about Christ, you're going to have four classes of people that you're going to experience, because Christ experienced those type of people. He would talk to people. Some would listen. What did the Jews do? In the Bible, it tells us the Jews did not what? Did not listen. They did not even care about what he was saying. So Jews were a certain type of people during that time. They heard, they knew of the word. Let's put it this way. You can know Christ, but do you really know Christ? You can love Christ, but are you in love with Christ? It's the same thing. When we're talking about the parables of the soil and the different classes of people, some love Christ. I love Christ. But then on the other side, you need to say, I'm in love with Christ. I know him. I have an intimate relationship with Christ. And that's the important thing. So here we go. It teaches that our Lord was under no illusion about the results of his work. That's what I'm talking about here. He was under no illusion. Three-fourths of it, we might say, seems that was a disappointment. The hearers listened to him, but only a third of them, only one-fourth of them really produced the right type of information or understanding that Christ wanted them to use. Jesus is now training the 12 for their mission in sending them out among the nations. And that's the Great Commission. Christ tells us in the Bible. He told, just before he left to heaven, he said, go out to Judea, Samaria, and throughout the world and tell them about me. And that's what we need to prophesy. Last night we talked about John the Baptist. He was the person that came to speak to the world about Christ. And he was coming. And how he was coming. That is so important. And he tells them that they must expect exactly what he was dealing with. Now, a special application of the parable of our text. If success depended upon the preacher and upon his character, here, listen to what I'm saying. If success depended upon the preacher and upon his character rather than the word, that success ought to have fallen to Jesus Christ. He's the only one that can come before us. Because if I come before you, it's not what I know, it's my character. Last time we were talking about fruits of the Spirit. Fruits of the Spirit have to be in us. And that is showing love and kindness and all the other fruits of the Spirit. So we were talking about Galatians 5, verse 22 and 23. And it talks about the fruits of the Spirit. And Christ had the fruits of the Spirit. He wants us to have the fruits of the Spirit. So the special application here is, let's go to John 5, 45. We're going to John 5, 45. Just a couple chapters back. If success depended on the preacher and upon his character rather than the word, that success ought to have fallen to Jesus. These are special applications of the parable part of this text. 5:45. What does the Bible say? And the Bible says, do not think that I accuse you to the Father. There is one who accuses you, Moses, in whom you trust. So, who would you trust? Jesus. Because he was the truth. He is the truth. Jesus is the truth. Turn your Bibles to chapter 7. 7 verse 13. What does the Bible tell us? We're trying to understand a special application of the parable of our text. And we're looking at John chapter 7 verse 13. And the Bible says, however, no one spoke openly of him for fear of the Jews. And 15, look at 15, verse 15. And the Jews marveled, saying, how does this man know letters having never studied? You know, because the world was expecting a warrior, a powerful general, somebody to come take over. The Jews were expecting somebody that was ready to go, ready to fight. But instead, they were blind to the word. They didn't open up the word, and that's what we need to do. In order to have the light, you have to read the word. And Jesus Christ came as a baby. And we've mentioned that during the seminars in the last couple of days. Christ came, but now the people are seeing him because we're talking a young man that grew up among them. Now he's speaking like marvel. People, when they seen Jesus speak, they were marveled with the way he spoke. Here was the truth for the disciples to keep in mind as they entered their ministry. The truth was what they had to ensure they understood before they went out to the world. They needed to understand the truth. A crop may fail for these three. Now, the seed may be at fault, and it may be bad. The soil may be bad. The sower may not have done his work properly. How many of you ever have grown gardens? Do you guys like growing gardens? Would we, in the desert, would we go out to the desert and plant tomatoes? Would we plant our seeds in the sand? Is sand a good base, a good basis? Does it have enough nutrients to germinate that seed, to make it grow? We need to mix it with things, right? I remember when we were younger, my father would walk around and show people fertilizer in his hand, because that's what he would do. He says, this is what it's going to do for your grass. This is what it's going to do for your garden. I love spending a lot of time out in the garden. When I go out there, I take my time and I work the soil and make sure it has the right nutrients, and then you plant your seed, and now it's just waiting for the miracle to happen. When in the mornings, when you get up in the morning, I like to eat fruits in the morning. And I look at the fruit and I say, man, this is a miracle. I thank the Lord for the people that planted that seed and the miracle that took place, that Christ helped germinate that seed to make it grow. And then that's exactly what we were talking about yesterday, the vine and the branches. We have to get connected to the vine, just like our plants. We want to make sure those plants grow. Your child, when they're born, they're small. What do you want to do? You want to make sure you take care of them, caress them, give them what they need to grow healthy, right? You want to make sure that they get enough food, and make sure they get their shots, and make sure that all those things take place. So as they grow, it becomes a positive thing. A crop may fail for those three reasons. The seed may be bad. The soil may be bad. The sower may not have done his work properly. I remember when we were young, they would take us out to the field, and we'd be cutting the plants and stuff to make sure that we loosen up the soil, because you have to loosen up that soil so the plant will grow and it'll get all the right nutrients and give it plenty of water. And of course, plants need plenty of sun. We all need plenty of sun, right? We need plenty of vitamin D. So as your plants grow, then you just continue to nurture those things. And we're coming around to how parable of soil applies to us today, as we are like that sower. These are all the factors that we just talked about. All the factors of that must not be overlooked. We cannot overlook one, because if you overlook one, then you're going to fail at growing the plants and the gardens and all those beautiful things that you like to do. So those are the three important factors. The four classes of hearers Jesus has in mind here, as described in this metaphor. The first one is on the pathway. This is our first of four that the parable of the soil is talking about. On a pathway, trodden, it tells us. The hearers comparable to the wayside of the beaten track. So the hearer first, on the pathway trodden hard by the feet of men. The scattered seed does not get much of a chance. So if you throw a seed right on the side, on a path that you walk on every single day, if you throw seeds there, is that seed going to grow? Is it going to find the right amount of soil? Is it going to find the right amount of light? It may have plenty of light. It lies upon the surface, and the birds that fly in the wake of the sower pick it up and carry it away. That's what happens when you throw the seeds on the side. And we're going to apply that to the word. Once you receive the word, how did you receive it? Was your ground hard? Was your heart hardened? That's the important thing that we need to understand. You know, our Lord knew that the roadside hearers, their minds do not take the word spoken. So when you're out there speaking to people, there's going to be people that When we were going out, passing out tracts recently, a couple of days ago, some people received the word with an open heart. Others, when we go to the door, they open up the door, they don't even give you that time of day, they slam the door in your face. And that's okay. Because Christ told us, you know, when we go to places like this, dust your shoes off and keep going. You planted the seed, you did your part. So that's important. The hearer's comparable to the stony soil. That soil is not well cleared. This is the second class of person. The soil is not well cleared of the rocks in that they hear and receive the word quickly, but when the heat of temptation comes, they wilt away. You have those that receive the word, but once pressures start coming, trials and tribulations, things that go on in your life, you have a tendency of backing off. This is not for me. That's the second class of the type of person, those that hear the word. Tonight you're here. You haven't left yet. You're listening to the word. When you leave that door, it's all up to you now. Because that's the way our God is. He doesn't force people to listen to his word or to obey his word. It's a free will God that we worship and love and cherish. So you have to really work hard on sustaining your relationship with Christ. This type of person, or this particular person here, is they received the word, but as temptation came, they fell away. You know, I in 1977, I decided I wanted to go off on my own. My parents signed the line for me to go into the military, and I went away. I was already backsliding, because from 1969 to 1977, we were in the church. I was in the church. I knew exactly where I was at. I loved God, but I wasn't in love with Him. I left all the way till I was 35 years old. I stayed away from the Lord, but I knew He was always calling me. And I fell into this class of person where I had the word. I knew about Christ. But when temptation came, and I told a quick story last night that talked about the temptations that I had, and it steered me away. And that may be happening with you tonight. Some of you may be going through so much. Some of you may have already heard the word once before. And you know exactly what Christ is, what He means, and that He's our Lord and Savior. But because the things that go on in your lives, the relationships that you create, the problems that come up in your lives, you come like this class of person. The third class of hearers that disappointed Jesus were the thorny ground hearers. People that believe the word, but are worried about making a living. How many of you live like that sometimes? I'm going to tell you this. When I got out of the military, when I retired, I went looking for a job. And I was already back in the church. And one of my main priorities, right up front, I wanted to tell them that I was a Seventh-day Adventist. And I don't work on Sabbath. I don't work on Saturdays. My particular department, we had auctions going on Saturdays. So I had to make my people work on the Sabbath. So what kind of Christian, what kind of example was I? I wasn't a very good example. So I prayed to God. I said, help me figure out how I can get through this, how we can change the way we do business on Sabbath. I don't want to make my people work. What kind of Christian am I if I'm making my people do what I don't believe I should be doing? And I told them, and they gave me the opportunity. And now we do all our auctions. I don't have to work my folks on the Sabbath or Sunday. We work from Monday to Friday, and we do online auctions. So the Lord blessed me and bless my team for me asking Him to help me figure out a way. And He will help you through anything you're going through in this day, in your life. Whatever you're dealing with, whatever problems or issues that you deal with, He's going to help you through these areas. So, it's important that we hold strong and firm to our beliefs. Whatever you believe in, you need to stay firm in what you believe in. People that lose this class of person, they lose interest in the word when financial posterity comes into their life, or whatever goes on in your life. That's that third class of person. So now we've learned about three classes of people. Those that heard the word, but they were not firmly grounded, and they fell away. Those that did hear the word, but when pressures and temptations came, they leave. That third class that we just talked about is when pressures of life come, they have a tendency of falling away. Now lastly, there was a class that was rewarded by Christ. And how many here want to be rewarded by Christ? Man, you got to have that relationship. You got to make that connection. You got to do that connection. You know, they were those who heard the word and understood it. They made the word part of their life. They accepted the truth humbly and kept it until it brought forth a rich harvest for the kingdom of God. So, you know, this last person is the person that Christ is looking for. Whatever problems you go through in your life, there's nothing bigger than Christ. And He can help you through whatever those difficult times are in your life. Some of you may be in that path of making a decision. You don't know what you want to do in your life. Well, I'll tell you, I made my decision. I made my decision when I came back to church and I started studying the Word. And that's what we all need to do. We need to study the Word and be diligent. Be diligent at studying His Word, because, you know, we praise God, like I said before, by reading His Word, by praying, and by singing praises to God. That's where that's important for all of us. We need to make sure that we continue there. Thus, we learn from the parable of the soil. You know, and how do we do that? How do we learn from the parable of the soil? Thus, you know, success or failure, whatever you're going through in your life, of our labors, and see, you know, we may labor. You may go out and you may preach to people or talk to people about Christ, and they may come to church for a little bit, and then they're going to fall away. You know why? Because they're not grounded. But it's our job to go out and keep talking to those that are dealing with difficult things in life, and stay in contact with them. Because I'll tell you right now, there's people in this sanctuary right now that are having problems. And if you don't know your fellow brothers and sisters, or someone to the left or to the right of you, you need to get to know them, just like you need to get to know Jesus. You know of Him, but you don't know Him. So the success or failure of our labors are by and large dependent upon the condition of the people we labor for. And we're laboring for, which Christ gave us the Great Commission, that's the labor for people to be saved, to help people, to let them know more about Christ. And that, you know, that the workers must not become discouraged when the results of the laborers are partial failure. That intensive condition of the hearts for success is paramount. You have to stay encouraged. You've got to stay motivated. Motivate each other. Motivate yourself. For you to get discouraged during the day and get depressed, God doesn't want you to be discouraged or depressed. He wants you to stay motivated. Think about some of the, you know, there's people, I was telling everybody during this past week, someday that the doors will be locked at that front and you won't be able to come into a church and worship, because the world is going to start taking its grip on us. Christ is coming soon. Just look around. Things are happening so quickly, so fast. Have you guys heard this new, this candidate for president, Ben Carson? Have you guys heard of him? He professes his faith. He's a Seventh-day Adventist. I don't know if you know that. He's a Republican. He is, he's an eloquent speaker. He's speaking about bringing back morals to this world. You know, we're not in charge. Christ, God is in charge. And we know our next president is going to be whoever God puts there, because He's going to press upon those hearts on who's going to be voted for. But if there's anything, if you look at politics at all, you'll see that there is Satan, good and evil, that are fighting against each other. Ben Carson, I believe, is a good man, and hopefully, Lord willing, that he'll let him go far enough. And we never know, he may become the next president, we don't know that. But he's a person that could be there, that could really turn things around for our world, for this world. We know, but the Bible tells us, the Bible tells us specifically that we have to be careful in the final days, that things, terrible things are gonna happen. But that's why we need to be grounded now. What type of soil are you? What type of person are you? Are you the type of person that once pressures come, you're gonna fall away by the wayside? Or are you gonna stay firm and love the Lord for what he is and for what he has done for us? That even the great master worker recognized the sower of the truth and the limitations that we have as humans. Christ didn't have limitations. As I mentioned earlier, Christ could stand here on his own character and you would know he was Christ. We stand here, we fall short of the glory of Christ, right? We fall short. And by our character and by the fruits that we put out and show others is what's going to show those people that we're trying to encourage and to bring along to understand more about Jesus Christ. You know, in closing, before they come up here, I just wanted to read something real quick. You have to continue praying for me this week, amen? I gotta have that energy. The parable of the four soils is fairly easy to understand. I hope you understood it this evening. To truly benefit from the parable, let me ask, what kind of soil are you? Are you like the wayside? If you have heard the gospel of Christ but have not obeyed it, you are in the process of hardening your heart the longer you wait. You know, it's like anything else in life. If you ever make a decision and you have to make a decision, the longer you wait and you let it fester in your mind, the harder it is going to be to make that decision. Do you agree with me? The longer you wait, because what happens is you start thinking of so many things come into your head, and before you know it, you don't make the decision. You are susceptible to Satan's deception. Of course, who's going to blind you to God's word? And that's exactly what Satan's job is, to blind you from his word. Are you like the stony ground? If you responded to the gospel but are not grounded in the faith, you will likely fall away. Then persecution or temptation comes your way. Are you like the thorny ground? If you responded to the gospel, but you're preoccupied with the cares and the riches and the pleasure of the world, you will be able to bear much fruit. And that's what God wants us to do. He wants us to bear fruit. He wants us to tell others about him. If you don't do that, you will not bear fruit. Remember that Jesus said about the branches that don't bear fruit. And if you were here last night, branches that don't bear fruit will be cut away. Just like in the last days, you have a chance, a choice, to make a decision. Because there's no medium. I was telling everybody last night, there's no medium ground. You're either for Christ or you're against him. You can't be in the middle. So that's important. Are you like the good ground? If you have responded to the gospel and are bearing fruit, then you have demonstrated several important things. You have a good and noble heart. You have come to understand the word. You have been keeping it with patience. And the word of God produced its intended effect on you, or will apply the intended effect on you. May this parable and its explanation by Jesus stimulate your minds, examine your hearts, and of course, the relationship that you have with Christ. The gospel's there for you to read and to understand. And that's my hope and prayer this evening. Amen.